So this one yesterday we have demonstrated, and in this demonstration we have seen this user constraint file. Till here, everybody in line with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So now, what I was yesterday telling, okay, go to this impact tool. So on this impact tool, you have to double click. So if you double click, then if you wait for a while, then it will open this one. There you click on this boundary scan, then right click, then initialize chain. So able to do this, this screen is seen by everyone, right? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let me initialize chain again. So now able to see here Xilinx, this XC3S500E, where I'm hovering my mouse, able to see people this one?
Yes, sir.
Everybody ensure yourself that what I'm telling you are seeing. If not seeing, you unmute and talk to me. I will assist you what people have to do so that you can see the screen. Those who are not able to see this screen, kindly unmute and talk to me. So you assuming everybody able to see, now let us proceed. You have this one, first one, if you see XC3S500E. Next you see there is a XC504S, there is another device, XC2C64 device. So these are the devices that are available on this board here. Let me go to that board now. Are you able to see this board now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. On this board, yesterday I was talking about this, where I'm pointing my this pencil here. So one chip is this one, what we call FPGA chip. The other chip is the CPLD chip. The other chip is ROM memory chip. Flash memory chip. So these chips are there. So these chips are seen here, at this picture here. First is FPGA. This is the CPLD. This is the memory chip. So if we want to configure this memory chip, this also we can configure. If we want to configure CPLD, this also we can configure. But since our current discussion is not to configure this memory chip or CPLD chip, our current discussion is to configure this FPGA chip, where I am hovering my mouse. So now what is the tool is stating? Do you want to continue? Do you want to continue and assign configuration file? So yes, I want to continue and I want to associate a file here, configuration file. So I clicked on yes. Now, everybody able to see here, this is automatically has taken me where my project folder is there. So there you see this ha.bit, able to see everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the configuration file. So this configuration file, yesterday we talked about this one. This consists of this one. Let me zoom bit here, this one. F8 and 2 plus for zooming. Okay, this configuration file consists this particular description, IO pins, this IO pins information, and also this information, what is to be implemented, that information, and this information, that is this pin information, particularly this this is there, this A is binded to which pin of that board. And likewise, B is binded to which pin on that board. So that information. So this put together is there in our the .bit file. So this user constraint file and this information, that is your this logic information, is there in your .bit file. This bitstream file. Now I am opening that one. So now the moment I opened there, new learners, especially I am communicating. Able to see everybody, earlier this was not there here, ha.bit was not there. Now you see here ha.bit, able to see this one?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So now what is that it is asking? The moment this file been associated with this FPGA, now it is prompting that this device supports attached flash PROM. So this one is a memory chip. So do you want to attach this? These are the supported files here, SPI or BPI PROM to this device. These are supported files. So I don't want to associate any file with this memory chip. So I click no. Now, what is that it is prompting here? In spite of clicking no, this has prompted me to pick a file that can be associated with this memory chip. So what I do here is, I have bypass here. I can click bypass. If I click bypass, it will go, this cursor will go here. Because it is again, it will ask, there is a CPLD, want to associate any file, configuration file with this CPLD. And again, the same message will come. If I click yes or no, then this will come. Want to bypass like that. So now what is my idea is just to demonstrate for you, in case if I don't want anything, I just straight want to configure this device, FPGA device, then what I can do is I can click on cancel all. So instead of doing cancel all, what I want to show is how this cursor will move to the next here. That I want to demonstrate. For that reason, I am just clicking on bypass here. So now the bypass, see, this cursor has moved here now to this CPLD device. So it is again asking here to pick the file that is related to that CPLD. So I don't want to configure CPLD as well. So I am clicking again bypass. So now after clicking the bypass, you see the cursor, it has come out here. So now what is that happening here is, I have this one FPGA and the device number it is here you see, and a PROM and the device number you see XCF04 and you see CPLD here, CPLD and the model number also you see. So now this particular bit configuration file I want to associate with this. So this one. So I by default it will be there on that only. In case if you are unknowingly if you are clicking, ensure that you are there on the FPGA here. So after that, what you have to do is click on apply and then OK. So after that, it will print this identify succeeded message. After that, on this device, you have first FPGA device, then memory device, then CPLD device. So which one we thought of configuring? This FPGA. So on that, I right click. I click on this program. So the moment I click on program, so this program succeeded message has come. Meaning this entire design, somebody unmuted, I think. Can you check and mute? If there is a need, then you unmute. Otherwise, kindly mute. So this one, now is configured onto this FPGA. So now let us go to this one here. Just a moment. Just locating here. Somebody mute, unmute, or mute. Sounds are coming. So everybody mute only, but I don't know why. So now, see, this one, you able to see everybody this device?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a moment, I am fixing. So I have to hold it steadily. So that is not happening, that's why it is shaking. Can you hold steady? It is not shaking. Okay. So yesterday we gave this one as a this one. This one. And this one as a B. These are the slider switches. Now everybody can see LEDs are not glowing. So this extreme right LED as a sum, and after that the next one as a carry we gave. So both slider switches, can you take closer to that? Further closer. hold it for a while like that. Everybody see the slider switches are down. Able to see?
Yes, sir.
Down here, because since down it is a logic zero, and you see LED where I am pointing here, LD zero and LD one, they are not glowing now. So what I do is now this I will make it high, this one, this this pin. So let me make that one high. So I made it high. Now you see LD zero is blinking. LED glown.
Yes, sir.
So this is our output. That is our this is A is one and B is still zero. That's why you see the sum. It's a glowing LED, and this is not glowing, this one carry. Similarly, now I will make this one down here, and the other one is up. Now also you see this is still glowing, that sum, and LD one, you see there is no it's not glowing it, this one. So now both I make high. So the moment I made both high, you see LD1 is now it's glowing and LD0 is not glowing. Is that seen by everyone there?
Yes, sir.
So now with this, what we are concluding is this. Can you go to the chip? This one. This chip where I am pointing my this one pencil. Instantly it has become IC. Instantly ASIC design, if you go for the ASIC design, then it takes some months, because we had to send that one to the fabrication. So now without sending it to the fabrication unit, we are able to test our design instantly, that is prototyping. So with this just I'm taking off this this particular video now. I think everybody has seen this one. Let us work out one more example later on. Now go to that one where this portion. So guys, those who are able to see this now, I switched my presentation to this one, this portion where devices are there. Able to see now?
Yes.
Yeah, that reason for taking acknowledgement from you all the time is this Google Meet. Sometimes somebody may be trying to present, such a notification not coming to me. That's why all the time I'm asking, acknowledging, taking acknowledgement from you people, whether able to see or not. Don't mind for that. So, but the point here is now what my point is, we simply wrote, especially to the newcomers, new learners, I am communicating, addressing this one. This code we wrote, and this code instantly we could able to see it on this FPGA. So meaning what, if you take here, for example, you go here, this just a moment, this one, where is that, the flow, if you take here, first one will be down here, flow will be like this. Once we take the specification, first we have to know the specification or functionality. Now what is that we have to do? We have to translate this specification or functionality to RTL. Everybody must be knowing what is meant by RTL now. A synthesizable Verilog code or VHDL code or any HDL code. This is Verilog or VHDL or any HDL. Any HDL, hardware description language. That is what RTL. RTL means a synthesizable code. So now you translate this specification to the RTL. Now you perform your functional simulation. After performing this functional simulation, this entire flow I am talking about ASIC design. not FPGA design. FPGA design is different. Earlier we spoke about this. There is a video on our YouTube channel. You can see the difference between ASIC approach and FPGA approach. I'm talking about this one related to this ASIC approach. So now after functional simulation, what you do, you need a library file and your Verilog file, these two, and constraints file. These three, we give it to a synthesizer. This synthesizer, this is a one tool. This functional simulation here itself, you need a tool, simulator. A tool is simulator, and here you need a tool. This is a synthesizer, and you also need a library from fab people, from fabrication foundry people. This foundry will give this lib file, library file. So your Verilog code, this one is your Verilog code .v file. So your constraints. So all these are given to your synthesizer. Now this will generate for you a netlist. This netlist again, in the backend tools, we have tools. Backend tools. These backend tools deal with floor planning, place, majorly speaking this one. But there are many things to speak here, that is the clock tree synthesis, design for testability, power grids or power rails, so this also comes here after floor plan. At this stage they may come here. Or this may, we may put even at this stage also. At this stage also it's possible to put, but most likely here also possible to put. This after floor plan stage. So these are the activities that we have to perform in the ASIC design. At every stage, here this and this and this, we have to perform timing simulation. And if everything is correct, then finally we go to that GDS2 file generation. This GDS2, this will have the information about chip fabrication information, to the foundry information. These people will understand that and they will send it to fabrication, that is making a mask of that, and the lithographic process, basically speaking, that is a lithographical process. So that process happens. So this is entire flow involved in a ASIC design. So this takes that's why I said this takes 2 to 3 months of time, depending upon the, again, complexity of the design, that is also there. So how complex your design is, so that may take 6 to 8 months off. Smaller designs, 3 or 4 months. If complex design, maybe 1 year also. So that is the complexity involved in the ASIC design. Whereas the FPGA design, this entire process, what we have seen, this entire process, we can do it in no time. In no time, you have written a Verilog code. I think in months, in a week, we can say in a week, weeks, we can complete this one, not this months. We can complete in weeks. So that is the power of this FPGA design approach. Earlier days, this FPGA basically meant for prototype. If anyone wants to go for ASIC, they first use it to prototype that design onto the FPGA. If FPGA working flawlessly, then they use it to go for the ASIC design for the mass production. But nowadays, these FPGAs and ASICs, almost they are working closer. I mean, suppose say ASIC is at 4 gigahertz speed, it is working. Then your FPGA is closer to 3.85 gigahertz. So such a closeness has come. So there is hardly any difference. So that's why people may be still using for the prototype, but they are also using it for application development, product development. Application development or a product development. For product development, what they are using? They are using these FPGAs. These FPGAs are used for the application of product development. Just because the reason is this, they are closer to ASICs only. They are fast enough now. So that's the power of these FPGAs. So that's why the guys, those who are there watching this, if you are good at this, you know, maybe Verilog or maybe VHDL or maybe system Verilog for a design. I am specifying here for a design, because system Verilog for verification is there, that is different. So anyone good at this, any one of these mentioned, so they can immediately apply for FPGA basic entry level jobs. Definitely they will get. The only requirement is one or two major projects they have to do on their own. On their own, you take some filter implementation, maybe biomedical filter or whatever, or maybe communication protocol, or maybe some other, you implement some DSP algorithm. So basic entry level jobs, if one is implementing this complete on FPGA as their project, you don't need to do from any institute this one. Again, I am against all that institutes wasting money, time and all. What is required for a candidate there is, this is required. Only this tool is required. Tool is available, as I'm telling you. Tool is available. Don't waste your time and money going to the institute. Tool is available. What is required then? Knowledge is required. What knowledge is required? If there is a DSP algorithm, master this DSP algorithm, how it is working. Then master your skills, HDL skills. How do you convert this algorithm to the HDL, RPL, that is your skill set, that is called skill set. You enhance your skill set, understand first DSP algorithm, and this algorithm, what you understood thoroughly, try to code it and come up with a RTL. The moment you come up with a RTL, what things are required for you to come to this RTL? You will need a simulation tool, that's it. Don't waste money in the institutes. You need a simulation tool, that's it. This simulation tool, there are a bunch of tools in the market available. we also demonstrated in the in our earlier classes. What is that we have demonstrated? Remembering everybody there. You remember this EDA playground?
Yes, sir.
So this is there. This is there for you people. So when this is there for you people, don't go to institutes. Don't waste your money. You master your DSP one algorithm or two algorithms. Develop a RTL code. Develop RTL code. First point is simulation. The moment you succeeded in implementing, your results are there. Your results are seen. Immediately make your CV. Put this algorithm I tested, and it is perfectly working. And put on that LinkedIn that professional network. Definitely entry level jobs will come, 100%. If not coming, then you can scold me or whatever. Definitely, 100%. I am sure. So likewise, those guys who are having communication protocol implementation, you study again the communication related algorithms are there. Develop your RTL, develop your understand thoroughly first algorithm, then translate that algorithm to this RTL, simulate. The moment the results are coming, you prepare your CV. And meanwhile, you also have to concentrate on synthesis. In this synthesis, then issues will come like. You have to apply timing constraints. That is industry main thing is whether timing constraints are met or not. What is the clock frequency it is working? Hold time violations are there or setup violations are there or not? So such questions will come up. Those are the advanced courses. Today some people ask in the WhatsApp group. You take up those also. Yes, I will take up those. But let us complete this basic level course first. So in that, how do we apply timing? That is also very easy. This is also, there is nothing hard sort of thing. The moment you are able to apply timing constraints to your design, then what is required again? Tool is required. You understood on paper you understood how to apply timing constraints. On paper it is. What is setup time? What is hold time? How violations occur? All that you studied in a paper, on paper you studied. Now to experiment it, what is needed for you? Tool, not institute. Institute is not required for you. Tool is required. And that tool is, there are several tools again available. This is the one tool. This is WebPack. So this is the WebPack. Those who are not aware, I'm telling for them this is WebPack. It's a free, it's synthesizable. Use it, synthesize it, your RTL code, apply this timing constraints on paper, what you have learned, and see that your design functional simulation, if it is working at 200 megahertz, for example, after applying this timing constraints, how closer it is working. Maybe it may work for 100 megahertz, or maybe it may work for 190 megahertz successfully. So that's it. Now what is next? Then next is immediately update your CV. Immediately update your CV and LinkedIn update on that. That this project earlier what I have simulated, this communication protocol or DSP protocol filter, them I also synthesized and target board is that. So I was getting this is the frequency after applying timing constraints. Without any violation, so I could able to make it work at this frequency. That way you brief your project and update your CV. So after that, what is next? After that, the next is this one. So whether that has passed, whether you fabricated that one with a chip fabricated, means obviously we cannot afford this one. And in India, there is a Chandigarh. In Chandigarh, there is a semiconductor. So to them, we can approach through IIT Guwahati professor. There's a professor name. Extremely sorry. I will update you tomorrow. So if you write to that professor will talk to semiconductor SCL Chandigarh. then what so far you have tested, you are sure that it was working for 180 megahertz, then that we can send it to ASIC. So now you may question that I targeted to the board. No, this board is nothing but that is FPGA. No, how can I send to fabrication fab people? That should be the immediate question there. How can I send this FPGA design to the ASIC people? Yes, you can send. How you can send, I will tell. We have open source tools. Open source tools. What for open source tools are there for you? For back-end design. I said earlier in the paint, that is not that I cannot get back that. So, you know that floor planning, and you know there is placement, and you know there is a route tool is for routing tool is required. So to carry out this, we have open source tools, and we can very much use this entire design what you have worked with the protocol instead of going to any institute and wasting your money freely sitting at home in your home. You can work complete your design on this open source tools. Now this open source tools, finally they will give you that GDS2 file. This file, after communicating to that IIT Guwahati professor, requesting him and convincing him that my design will work, and I want to fabricate that one. So SCL people, our the Chandigarh people are helping institute, I mean candidates, those who are really fond of learning industry related techniques, for them they are very much encouraging. This GDS2 file we can send to this fabrication. That is one thing. If we want this ASIC approach. If we don't want ASIC approach, then FPGA itself is possible. This design, once you go here, this where just a moment. In this, you have generate post static timing. This point, and even here, you have constraints here. Where is that user constraints? These constraints, you have create timing constraints. These are the timing constraints. So if you click this again, timing constraints are different. This is the advanced topic course we will study. Just I'm showing you what you can do. This timing constraints you can apply here to your design. You see this here, timing constraints, you can apply group constraints are there. Several to learn all this to learn here. We have to learn all this. So you can very much use them. Understand what is actually basically the timing constraint is, why timing constraint is important, how I can apply timing constraint. And there is a tool for you freely available. You can do even on this FPGA approach. Now ensure that after applying timing constraint, your design is really working at this. Either way, this approach or this approach. Immediately what you have to do, update your CV again. No institute, nothing. The other day, the other week, you will see job opportunities. If you have potential zeal, you will follow these methods, what I'm telling, though, without wasting your money in the institutes. So today, why instead of going to the subject straight, why I took up this discussion is I'm seeing several people going to institutes, obtaining the certificates. I'm fed up with all that. You have, suppose, 100 certificates with you. All these 100 certificates are given by whom? Bangalore top, suppose, institutes. Who Bangalore top institute means? This our VLSI field institutes. Suppose you have how many? 100 certificates are there. But you are the person without any potential. Your potential is zero. Zero potential. Okay, having seen 100 certificates, the VLSI top Bangalore institutes, company has given you a job. So what will you do in the company, that you tell me? what will you do? Having 100 certificates, what will you do? You will not do anything. The other day you will be kicked off from that company. So for that, don't run after the institutes, run after understanding this concepts, these concepts like algorithm. What is, for example, you have, for example, everybody today just refer what is booth multiplication. This is simple algorithm. Just I'm telling you how to start. What is booth multiplication? This is how you had to start. Just I'm letting you know to the new learners there, how you start your career, you know, the direction, right direction. Pick any one, not necessarily this multiplication, I'm just giving example. If you are interested in DSP, pick a DSP book. In DSP book, what you do, there are several things again in that filters are there, several other things are there. You pick any of the topic that you are interested in the DSP. You have your IR filters are there, FIR filters are there, what not. You pick any one. So understand this one, how it is functioning. So for that, instead of going to the complex examples, I thought of picking a small example. You pick a, so this one. Now what you have to do, you have to translate this thoroughly, having the concepts of this boost multiplication, translate that to the RTL. So now what is RTL? You know very well. What is RTL? A synthesizable code, any synthesizable code. It's synthesizable. From here, every story I told earlier. The moment you succeed in simulation, update your CV. The moment you synthesize, update your CV. The moment you apply timing constraints, maybe a PG approach, ASIC approach, no problem, but update your CV. The other week, job will come, definitely job will come in a good company. No institute, nothing. So if you think even after doing this one, no, I need a good institute guidance. Then you if you still feel like having a requirement, then you go. But on your own, you work all this. Then you go to the good institute. In case, still if you are feeling like that. Actually not required. If you do all these steps, if you update your CV, definitely 100% job will come. That I am assuring you. But still, if you feel like that, you can go. Are you people there? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So that's the point here. No one should run after the immediately. Don't take any decision. Today, I just thought of discussing all this because on WhatsApp typing and all my feelings, I cannot convey you. So my feelings, I can convey you directly on direct communication. So I'm asking you, you people there, you some may be not having interest in digital domain. I don't know how many of you are new here, but previously I spoke the jobs available in the VLSI field. On that, there is a video in our WhatsApp YouTube channel. So you refer that. So somebody may be interested in digital. Somebody may be interested in analog. Somebody may be interested in mixed signal IC design. Somebody may be interested in RFIC design. This complete design point of view I'm talking. Somebody may be interested in a verification. Somebody may be interested in a DFT, design for testability concepts, to apply for even analog or to apply for digital or to apply. They may come up with innovative ideas like that. Or maybe RFIs. So you plan accordingly. This domain is for you good, or this domain, I mean, interest. Good means your interest in which you are interested in. I address those who are not sure, for them I will address some other day. But today, the reason for asking is such a easy things are there at your hand. At your disposal. You people don't waste your money running after the institutes. let us go to our discussion now. So hope you understood this one. We'll demonstrate one or two examples. So today we demonstrated half adder. Few more we'll demonstrate. So let us go to this one. Today straight we go to the other topic. Just a moment. Okay guys, so back here to the subject here now. We last time did this one here. Let me go here where it starts. You are very long. So the time is we are running out of time here. What is the time left? Just 10 minutes left. I think enough slides are there. Let us start with the behavior level modeling, because this is the final one. With this we have to wrap our this current ongoing classes. Guys, there able to see this one?
Yes sir.
Yeah. So guys, those who are not familiar with what is this called, behavioral level modeling, those who are familiar kindly bear with me, correct me, and those who are not familiar just listen. So we have basically several modeling techniques we have seen in the past. We have seen several. So among these several, we started with our this one, switch level, introducing what is switch level, and then we introduced that is gate level, and then we introduced data flow. That was the last we have seen, so data flow level modeling, and then we are now picking this our behavioral level modeling. So there is another structural level that also we have demonstrated in between sessions several times. So this is a structural level modeling. So guys, here this one ruled out in industry, this one also ruled out in industry, this one not ruled out in the industry, data flow, because from here all the operators we still use, operators are required here, we still use, and we still use assign also. That's why this is not totally ruled out from the industry point of view. And coming to your behavioral level modeling, this is the heart of the industry actually. So we mostly use for RTA development 99% this behavioral level modeling only. So once we submodule, so like your big project is here, suppose you have your ALU design. In this ALU design, you have arithmetic unit, you have your logical unit. Again, in arithmetic unit, you have several arithmetic units, so maybe plus, maybe minus, maybe multiplication, maybe division, whatnot. Again, in logical, again, several are there. So finally, what you do is you put into that top module, this top module. This top module may be having only primary inputs and only primary outputs. And some selection, what is that you want, some selection, maybe some arithmetic, maybe some logical operation. And you want to see them here at the output side. Through this selection. So now this inside the top, you simply instantiate either this data level you might have developed with this I call leaf cells or lower modules. You might have developed them at using data flow level modeling or behavioral level modeling, no matter. But you simply connect them. You connect them here. You have one IC1. You have IC2. How do you connect ICs, physical ICs, in case if output needs to go here to here and here to here? How do you connect? This is how you connect. So similarly, we instantiate modules. We in the previous lectures, we have seen this terminology, instantiate. So we instantiate these modules developed in the behavioral level modeling or data flow level modeling into our top model. So that is this structural level. We have seen several times in the past while we have shown some example codes, structural level modeling. So now this is what we have. Our agenda is this one today, behavioral level modeling. In this behavioral modeling, you have basically, this is always, you notice here in this, always you notice. This always, let me take another. This is a always, it's a keyword. And there is another keyword called initial. These are the procedural constructs. These are the procedural constructs that we have. Anything we write code that goes in this always or inside the initial. So inside this always or inside this initial goes, we call such statements as the procedural statements. Procedural. We call them procedural statements because after all they are under the procedural constraints. That's why we call them procedural statements. If multiple procedural statements are there, we need a begin and end. If multiple are not there, then only one statement is there. Begin and end is not required. This begin and end is not required. So remember, we are talking about behavioral level modeling. In the behavioral level modeling, the main heart is this always and initial. Now the question comes, always we have to think in terms of tool support, in terms of simply as a language we should not learn, we have to learn like a hardware designers. In that way, we have to learn. What hardware designer will look for? Hardware designer will look for all the time netlist. He or she will look for netlist. What is netlist means? It may be anything that is a digital, maybe your gate or maybe flip-flop and their interconnection. In terms of that, he or she will look. Meaning what? Ultimately, this language should give you this netlist. To whom? To hardware designer. That's why don't think like in the language point of view. Language point of view, who will think? The programmer will think. We are not programmers. We are hardware designers. We have to question that whether this construct is synthesizable or not. That question should come into your mind all the time. Remember, if I use always, is that supported by the tool for synthesis? If I use initial, is it supported by the tool for synthesis?